Hey Anna, can I get some Kleenex?
Yeah, sure, Gabby.
This cleaning stuff is back-breaking work. It's almost like we should get an Olympic medal for it.
I know. I feel like there's already a sport like that or something.
Let's go check it out. Gabby, we should go here.
What a good idea! I've always wanted to know the physics of curling.
The arena is a sheet of pebbled ice that is 150 feet long by approximately 15 feet wide. At the end of each sheet, there are four concentric circles, each called a house. At the center of each house is the button.
Curling requires a rock.
No, not that rock. That rock.
A broom to sweep the ice with, and shoes, one of Teflon and one of rubber.
Each team consists of the lead, who throws the first two rocks, the second, the third, and the skip, the team leader.
At the start of a typical curling match, you'll see the lead and the rock at one end of the sheet, and you'll find the second and the third waiting with brooms to sweep. The lead will throw the rock, and the second and the third will wait for the skip to tell them to start sweeping.
Each team throws 8 rocks per end, aiming for the house. They can strategize by throwing directly to the button or hitting an opponent's rock out of the house. At the end of each round, the team with the rock closest to the button wins, with their points being the total number of rocks that are closer to the button than the closest opponent's rock. If this is the end of one end, then you'll find that yellow wins the round because their rock is in the button. But there are 2 yellow rocks closer to the button than the closest red rock, so the yellow team would score 2 points in the first end.
Here's a great example of Team USA knocking 2 of Sweden's rocks out of the house in the 2018 Olympic gold medal match. Each player wears a curling shoe with a rubber sole and a Teflon sole. The rubber sole is for walking and the Teflon is for sliding. If I rewind the video and play it in slow motion, you can see the uses of the different soles in action. How does that work, you ask? Let's take a closer look at the physics behind curling shoes.
Here's a free body diagram of Alexander's curling shoe on pebbled ice. The force of friction is keeping the shoe from moving forward and is found using the coefficient of friction mu times the normal force. In order to move forward, the player exerts a pushing force that must be larger than the force of friction. Each material, however, has a different texture and thus a different coefficient of friction. In order to find out why rubber is used to walk on pebbled ice and Teflon is used to slide on pebbled ice, we carried out an experiment to find the coefficient of friction of rubber and Teflon on pebbled ice.
The materials you need are Teflon, rubber, a tape measure in centimeters, and some homemade pebbled ice.
So we're going to put each of these materials on the ice and tilt it until right before it slips, and then measure the height, and we'll have the hypotenuse, and then we can find the angle. So to start, we need to know the hypotenuse, which is 16.8 centimeters. And then we'll get the height of each one as we go along.
First, we're going to find the coefficient of friction of rubber. So I'll put that on the pebbled ice, and then I'll tilt the sheet of ice until the rubber starts to slip. It was about right here that it started to slip.
Here's the triangle formed by the tilted ice at the moment before the rubber began to slide. Now we must solve for the angle of elevation marked x. We know that sine x equals opposite over hypotenuse. In this case, sine x equals 7 divided by 16.8. We can solve for x by taking the sine inverse of 7 divided by 16.8. Thus, x equals 24.62 degrees. We carried out this experiment 7 times and calculated the average angle.
To understand the importance of observing the average angle at which the material begins to slide, let's take a look back at an animated version of the experiment. Here is a piece of rubber on a tray of pebbled ice. We tilted the tray until the instant before the shoe began to move. Recall again how we explained the free body diagram of a curling shoe on flat ice, but what happens now when the ice is at an angle? The normal force is still represented by an arrow perpendicular to the surface of the rubber on ice. The force of friction is still keeping the rubber from sliding down the ice. The force of gravity is represented by an arrow going directly downwards. Now, let's make this more like a typical free body diagram, where the rubber is represented by a dot, and the normal force is straight upwards. Using vector addition, we can separate the force of gravity into its x component and y component. Finally, we can rearrange the arrows representing gravity for a complete free body diagram of a curling shoe sole.
The normal force and the force of gravity in the y direction cancel each other out, as both are equal to mg cosine theta, but in opposite directions. In solving for equilibrium, then, we can set the net force equal to the force of friction minus the force of gravity in the x direction. Replaced with the equations, we find that the net force equals mu times f of n minus mg sine theta. But we also know that force equals mass times acceleration. Therefore, mass times acceleration equals mu times f of n minus mg sine theta. Finally, we put mg cosine theta in for the normal force, and we have the unsimplified equation with the coefficient of friction mu. To simplify, we can first see that mass is in every chunk of the equation. Then add g sine theta to both sides. Finally, divide by g cosine theta. We're measuring static friction, meaning that at equilibrium the shoe still isn't moving. Therefore, acceleration should be zero. We can cross out g from the numerator and denominator to get sine theta over cosine theta equals mu. Sine over cosine equals tan. So we get the final simplified equation for mu. The instant before the shoe falls, we find that theta at which tan theta equals mu.
Going back to the experiment, we found the average angle at which the x component of gravity is about to overcome the friction of rubber on pebbled ice is 28.71 degrees. Plugging it into the equations, we find that the coefficient of friction of rubber on pebbled ice is 0.547. We repeated the experiment with Teflon and found the average angle to be 20.37 degrees. Therefore, the coefficient of friction of Teflon on pebbled ice is 0.371. In conclusion, Teflon has a smaller coefficient of friction than rubber. The data shows that the slipperier one, Teflon, is not too slippery so that you don't fall when you're on the ice, and that the rougher one, rubber, isn't too rough that you can't still slide.
Another important part of curling is the sweeping.
Sweeping heats the ice, causing a thin film of water to appear in front of the rock, therefore reducing friction in front of the rock and allowing the rock to glide about 10 feet farther. Sweeping also creates micro scratches on the pebbles. The orientation of the scratches on the pebbles and on the bottom of the rock can change the direction of motion of the rock.
The midsection of the rock is made out of granite that is more bouncy so that it doesn't shatter upon impact and won't wear down easily. The only part of the rock that actually touches the ice is a ring about 6 millimeters wide underneath the rock. The bottom of the rock is made out of a type of granite that has the lowest friction.
Notice how, in this 2014 Olympic match, the rock thrown by the curling team from Japan curls in the same direction it is spun. It is quite unusual for an object to act in such a manner. For example, spinning a cup counterclockwise on a table would cause the cup to curl clockwise. So why does the rock curl in the same direction of its spin? Here are a few physics theories that attempt to explain the phenomenon.
When you spin a cup counterclockwise, the force in the front pushes it to the right and the force in the back pushes it to the left. Because the force in front is stronger than the force in the back, the cup follows the front force and spins clockwise. When you spin a curling rock counterclockwise on the ice, you would expect the same result, but actually the rock spins counterclockwise.
One theory of why this occurs is because the pressure at the front of the rock melts some of the ice to create a thin layer of water. Here is a free body diagram of the rock moving on pebbled ice. In this case, the centripetal force, or the force necessary to turn, is equal to the force of friction. Therefore, the centripetal force also equals mu times Fn, and the centripetal force is directly proportional to the coefficient of friction. As the pressure on the front of the rock creates a thin layer of water, the friction on the front of the rock decreases because the mu of the rock on ice is greater than of the rock on water. Thus, the centripetal force of the front of the rock decreases, and the force of the back of the rock,
spinning it counterclockwise, takes over.
Another theory is that as the rock spins and slides along the ice, the leading edge etches curved scratches in the ice. As the back half passes over these scratches, they gently push the rock along the ice in the direction of the grooves, which is the same direction that the rock is spinning in.
The last part of the physics of curling is strategy. We need to understand how curlers know how fast and at what angle to throw and then sweep the rock so it hits their opponent's rocks out of the house. See how Team USA stops sweeping after a certain point and the yellow rock hits two red rocks out of the house? It looks like an elastic collision. In elastic collisions, momentum and kinetic energy are conserved. In this real-world example, momentum is still conserved, but kinetic energy is not because there is sound and friction.
The equation for conservation of momentum is seen in this equation. But since the masses of the rocks are equal, they cancel out. In order to find the magnitude of the final velocity and the initial velocity, we turn our graph to assume that the yellow rock is coming straight down and hits the red one at an angle of 14 degrees. We substitute a negative 14 degrees for theta final, and negative 90 degrees for theta initial and theta red in this equation, resulting in this equation.
To find the force of impact in the x direction, we use the impulse momentum theorem, with time of impact being 0.23 seconds, which we timed in the video. The mass of the rock is 19.96 kilograms, and the change in the x from the previous equation. This process was repeated for the y direction. The resulting force vector with both directions is shown here.
Now we know that F dot D equals change in kinetic energy. We have F and we have D, which is practically zero since the impact didn't displace much of the rock. But what about change in kinetic energy? It's not just 1/2 mv squared because the rock is also spinning, so delta Ke is seen in this equation.
To find I, we assume that the rock has the same moment of inertia for our sig fig purposes as a solid cylinder, which is 1/2 mr squared. With help of the internet, we found the radius to be 0.1448 meters and plugged that in with the mass to get a moment of inertia of 0.20925 kilograms times meters squared.
We measured omega based on this video, measuring the angle the rock started at to the angle it ended at after 1 second, and converted that to radians per second. Finally, we plugged all of these numbers into the equation for an imperfectly elastic collision to get a simplified equation for velocity final and velocity initial.
We estimated velocity initial after Team USA finishes sweeping to be about 4 meters per second. Note that this isn't the initial velocity of the rock from being thrown. It's after sweeping, where the velocity can be controlled by the curlers. Plugging 4 into this equation, we find that V final is 4.002 meters per second.
Now that we have velocity final and velocity initial, let's go back to our first equation. We just measured the angles as if the yellow rock is moving straight down, but we can clearly see that it isn't. We can keep velocity initial and velocity final because those magnitudes are not affected by the angle. However, let's not use negative 14 degrees. Instead, we're going to solve for theta initial, the angle at which the rock is moving when the sweeper stops sweeping so that it hits both red rocks out of the house.
If we look back at the geometry of the rocks, we can see in this diagram that the yellow is coming in an angle of theta I. It hits the first red rock, which then moves at theta I, but the yellow rock changes direction. We want the yellow to hit the second rock at an angle of negative 18 degrees, but that's measured from the x-axis. The yellow is clearly not coming from the x-axis, so we need to add a variable, A, to the 18 degrees to find the new angle of motion.
We can see that A is also the angle at which the sweepers should stop sweeping to ensure that the yellow rock hits both red ones.
Now we can go to this equation based on the conservation of momentum and plug in our numbers. We still have two unknowns, V red and A, but since we're trying to solve for A, we estimated V red from the video to be 6 meters per second.
Plugging this equation into the calculator, we get two angles, 78 and negative 12 degrees. Based on the picture, we see that the angle has to be in quadrant 1, so we know that A equals 78 degrees. Thus, the sweepers can stop sweeping when the rock is 78 degrees from the x-axis.
In the 2018 Pyeongchang Olympics,
the men's U.S. curling team won gold for the first time.
And now you know how!